Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Outlaw's Tale by Margaret Frazer, narrated by Susan Duerden. O hateful harm, condition of poverty, with thirst, with cold, with hunger so confounded, to ask and help thee shameth in thine hurt, if thou noon ask, with need our toe so wounded, that very need unwrappeth all thy wound ahid. Maugre thine heed, thou most for indigence or steal, or beg or bore we by dispense. The Man of Law's Prologue, Canterbury Tales, Geoffrey Chaucer. Chapter 1. The green shade of the forest was streaked and flecked with shifting gold sunlight. In the patterns of shadow and light, the dozen men sat or leaned or lay at ease against the great boles of the trees and their high-humped roots. Only their leader stood straight, his arms folded across his chest, his weathered, not unhandsome face creased deeply by his smile.
"So," he said, "we're agreed we must not dine this day without an unexpected guest come to our table."
His men's grins answered his own at the jest. Their leader eyed them all, considering, then said,
"Will Scarlet, Little John and, Hal, Evan, you bring our guest from the Greenwood Road."
Will stood and swept his filthy red hat off in a bow that was far more elegant than his ragged-hemmed green tunic and patched-out brown hosen.
"My Lord Robin, as you say, so shall it be."
But among the other men who had risen, two were shoving at each other, trying to shoulder one another out of the way.
"I'm Little John this time," the smaller of them claimed. "It was me he looked at."
The other, hardly medium tall, made a rude noise.
"Sit down, lack inches. John is the big one. This is for me."
A third man lounged upright from a tree, broad-shouldered, but no taller than either of them.
"Now there, you're both wrong. If anyone's Little John, it's me. And aside from the fact I can butt both your heads together when I want, I'm the best of us at quarterstaving. For which there won't be much use on this adventure," called one of the men, still leaning against another tree. "Come on, Nicholas, before it comes to blows, which one is Little John?"
Their leader pointed at the medium tall man.
"You,"
and added to the broad-shouldered man over the general laughter and comments,
"you can go fetch the venison with Tom."
There was a groan from both Tom and the erstwhile Little John at that, and jeers at them from everyone else. The chosen Little John went to join Will and Hal, where they waited at the clearing's edge. The fourth man, still stretched on his back with a root for a pillow, his eyes closed to the pleasure of a sunbeam on his face, said without moving,
"Maybe someone instead of me. I might be recognised. She's not a fool, and neither is the steward."
Nicholas considered that and nodded.
"Right enough. If this fails us, we'll need you for later. Cullum, go instead."
With a pleased chuckle, a short, freckled, brawny fellow rose to join Will and John and Hal. In a falsetto that went but poorly with his wide chest, he sang a cheerful parody of a maidservant's holiday song. "I've waited long for today, spindle, bobbin and spool away. In joy and bliss I'm off to play upon the king's highway." The four of them disappeared by a faint path into the leaf-shadowed forest, leaving more laughter behind them. Quietly, Evan said, from where he still lay beneath the tree,
"You know, Nicholas, you play that jest over much sometimes. I think there are days you really believe you're Bold Robin, and we're his merry band."
The winter of the year of our Lord's Grace, 1434, had been cruel with frost and snow, and the spring had been harsh and cold. There had been fears of a famine year like the last, but May was come, and fair weather with it. Frevisse still wore the cloak she had put on at dawn when they left the priory, but it was thrown back over her shoulders. Sister Emma had long since shed hers, with much fussing and bundling, and wondering whatever could be down with it, until Master Naylor had taken it and strapped it with his own behind his saddle. The three of them rode in no great haste, abreast, across the crown of the road, to avoid each other's dust. Frevisse had long since relaxed into the pleasure of the journey and the warm day, lulled by her horse's easy rhythm and soothed by the sweet air. She was even past being bothered by Sister Emma's chatter. Summer flowers arrayed the wayside grass and hedgerows with their rich yellows, purples, whites, and sometimes reds and sky-caught blues. Birds sang as if making up for their lost spring. Everywhere was green, fields and pastures and rough road edges well into their summer growth. Here along the uplands to where the road had climbed were flocks of sheep and their leggy, bright-faced lambs. The hollow clappering of their wooden bells kept company with the birdsong. The summer-smelling air was warm on Frevis's face, where it was free of her white wimple and black veil, and she had found that after so long confinement to nunnery walls, she had forgotten how wide the sky could be. Deep blue today, and adrift with mounded, shining clouds. And this afternoon, they would ride through a forest. How long had it been since she had ridden through a wood? They would be 5 days away from St. Frideswyd's, Frevisse thought, or more if the weather changed and they were delayed. She felt a little guilty at the pleasure in that thought, but reminded herself that she was come not because she'd sought to, but as Domina Edith's choice for Sister Emma's companion. But then, in all honesty, she suspected the prioress had chosen her to accompany Sister Emma to her niece's christening, because Frevis's winter restlessness had grown past hiding as spring came on. The journey would have its trials. Sister Emma was a constant chatterbox, whose tongue ran as if on wheels whenever freed from the nunnery's rule of silence. But at the prioress's order to accompany her, Frevis's winter longing had risen free in her, like a fire blown upon. Sister Emma's chatter had seemed nothing when set against the chance of riding out from St. Frideswyd's into everything that had been calling to her all this while from beyond the priory walls. Now, though, she had been in Sister Emma's company 5 hours, and the pleasures of travel were already dimming under the constant flow of her voice and the knowledge that there would be 4 more days of it. They would reach Sister Emma's cousin's house before Vespers today, and tomorrow ride on, in company with the family, to her brother's house in Burford. The christening would be the day after that, and then 2 days to return to St. Frideswyd's. She closed her eyes. 5 days of Sister Emma's unabated chatter.
"And it's so hot. I never thought it would be this hot, and it's only May. Still, that will help the hay along, I dare say, and that's to the good. Are the Priory's meadows doing as well as they should be, Master Naylor? We nuns pay more attention to such things than you'd think, you know. And we notice when things go ill, and there's been enough of that lately, hasn't there? But it's all to the better now, I trust."
Master Roger Naylor, the Priory steward, nodded. He had come with them as their necessary escort, and would ride on alone from Sister Emma's cousins to tend to Priory business in Oxford, and return for them after the christening. He was not given to talk at the best of times, and his long, lined face rarely showed more than concentration on the task at hand. Frevisse suspected he had stopped actually heeding anything Sister Emma said miles ago.
"And the dust! Really, should the roads be this dusty so early in the summer? Are we short of rain? Hasn't it rained enough of late? I should think it had, except this road is so dusty, and such heat. I could almost wish it were raining. It would be pleasant to ride in the rain, don't you think? A cool, gentle rain."
She sighed at the blissful thought.
"And I've read somewhere that rain is good for the complexion. Or maybe my sister told me that. Not my sister-in-law, who has the new baby. Another girl. But they've had 2 boys, too, so it isn't so bad. But my sister Bertille. Yes, I'm sure she told me a gentle rain is good for the complexion. She always rinses her hair in rainwater, and she's always had beautiful hair. It's a pity her nose is shiny pink. It's all those colds she has. Not that I don't catch colds easily, but not so easily as she does. You remember her, don't you, Dame Frevisse? She came to visit me Easter before last and brought me new handkerchiefs. I do go through handkerchiefs like a wastrel through his inheritance, and was so grateful for them. But at least there's no danger of catching cold today. It's so hot.
It will be cooler in the woods, Frevisse offered.
Yes, yes, it will. I do love the forest. I always have. All my family does. Oh, we did love to go maying in the woods when I was a girl. Everything's so beautiful.
Frevisse did her best to stop listening. The road dropped from the sheep-grazed uplands in long, easy slopes. There was a village, and they paused to buy ale and eat some of the food the kitchener had packed for their going. Familiar nunnery food, of brown unbuttered bread and some withered apples left from last autumn's harvest, tasting the better for being eaten sitting on an unfamiliar well curb. There were few villagers about, everyone too busy in the fields this time of year to have spare interest for casual passers-by. Only a threesome of small urchins in loose tunics, barefooted and bareheaded, came to scuffle and stare at them from a safe distance, and skittered off giggling when Frevisse turned to stare back. When they had finished eating, Frevisse found she could have gone on sitting there a while in the pleasant sunshine. It had been rather too long since she had been riding, and there were already twinges of the stiffness she would have tomorrow. Besides, the place was pleasant. The day was hardly half gone, and they were already more than halfway to Sister Emma's cousins. But Master Nail arose and said, firm and sensible,
"So, let's be on, then."
"Neither fair weather nor daylight last forever," Sister Emma agreed. "So journey while you may."
Sometime in her girlhood, she had read a book of wise sayings and was fond of showing how many she remembered. Now she bounced her feet and set about tidying her black habit, brushing away crumbs, real and imaginary, and straightening her wimple and veil. More slowly, Frevisse followed suit, knowing what was coming. They had already been through putting Sister Emma on her horse this morning in the nunnery's stable yard. Now the ordeal would have to be gone through again. At Sister Emma's fussy insistence, Master Naylor first checked all her horse's girths and bridle straps to be sure they were secure, and then that the horse was well tied and could not sidle. She had chosen to have a box saddle that let her ride sitting sideways and ladylike, but since she was somewhat short and round, she could not mount it by herself without an especially tall mounting block. St. Frideswyd's had had one, the village did not, and so Master Naylor was going to have to take her by the waist and lift her into the saddle. Frevisse expected Sister Emma would manage a lengthy session of false starts, reprimands, instructions, and fits of giggling at the impropriety of it all, before letting Master Naylor accomplish his simple task. But Master Naylor grasped her firmly between his two hands, lifted her swiftly, and plopped her ungracefully into her seat before she had barely begun to squirm. Surprised and somewhat jarred, Sister Emma stared at him, words momentarily failing her. Master Naylor turned away to Frevisse, who had been standing beside her own horse, watching with unseemly amusement. She shook her head. A stable boy had held her bridle when she mounted this morning, but she was more confident now. Old skills had come back to her. She had asked for an ordinary saddle, one that let her ride astride, the way she had ridden both in her childhood and after she had come into the care of her Uncle Thomas Chaucer, who knew more than many about the manners of the best-born of England, and agreed that safety and ease of riding were to be preferred over fashion. Now, with her reins gathered in her hand, she swung herself up into the saddle, ignoring Sister Emma's tut-tutting as completely as she had ignored it this morning. She smiled down at Master Naylor and caught the trace of a smile at the corners of his mouth before he nodded to her and went away to his own horse. The forest was not much further on. They approached it gladly and were thankful for its shade as they entered. Sister Emma exclaimed,
"Such a blessing to be out of that dreadful sun! Oh, it's lovely here, so green and cool. Is the way short or long through here, Master Naylor? I hate to think we'll just be comfortable and have to go out again. Which way is it, Master Naylor?"
With an effort, the steward stirred himself to ask,
"Which way is what, my lady?"
"Is this way long or short through the woods? I really don't want to be out in the sun again."
"There'll be woods until almost the end."
"Well, that's a blessing," Sister Emma said. All the same, a dry May and a dripping June makes all things come into tune. Or so I remember it.
Frevisse stopped listening again. There were the new savours of the forest to enjoy, and she did. By law, the undergrowth was cleared well back on either side of the road, to leave no concealment for anyone who might mean trouble. But the great trees had been left to throw shade across the road for travellers' comfort. The sunlight was gentled under the green branches. The horses' hoof-falls and creak of their harness softened. Woodbine grew in the long grass of the verge. And though there was no birdsong now in early afternoon, the flash of wings crossed their way now and again, and there were rustlings in the leaves. They were somewhere several miles into the wood and had just crossed a stream when Master Naylor's head lifted a little higher with alertness and his hand went to his sword.
"Are the travellers?"
"Oh, wonderful!" Sister Emma exclaimed. "We've seen nearly no one. Won't it be pleasant to see someone and wish them good day and God's blessing? A soft answer turns away wrath where a harsh word stirs up anger, so they say."
Frevisse sighed at this inapt quote and thought they also said that a wise man conceals his wisdom while a fool announces his foolishness. A bend in trees had hidden the other wayfarers until they were nearly met, but they were in sight now. Four men, all on foot, no more than peasants by the look of them, bound for somewhere, bearing bundles on their backs, and trudging as if they had come miles already and had miles more to go. Probably sent by their lord on an errand that did not warrant better service, Frevisse thought. She was aware of Master Naylor eyeing them as he and she edged their horses sideways to give the men their share of the road. The men themselves also gave way, dropping into single file on their own side, the heads still down. Sister Emma, never a steady hand on the reins, and worse for her awkward seat, had fallen back as Frevisse drew aside, but could not manage her horse sideways out of the men's way. Frevisse turned in her saddle to frown at her as the first man passed her own horse. He would need to crowd to the roadside to avoid Sister Emma's. But too suddenly for any warning, he dropped his bundle, straightened, and grabbed hold of Sister Emma's bridle. In almost the same moment, the other three men were in sharp motion with him, their bundles in the dust, one of them grabbing for Frevis's reins, the other two leaping for Master Naylor. Frevisse jerked her horse's head away and tried to kick it forward to ride the man down. But the horse was nunnery bred, gentle to a fault. It balked and sidled, and the man had her reins. Frevisse tried to kick at him, but her skirts hampered her. He dodged without losing his grip, grinning up at her. Master Naylor, with two against him, was out of his saddle. One man had gripped his leg and heaved him sideways and over in a single motion, pitching him to the ground on the far side of his horse. The fourth man ducked under the horse's upthrown neck to fall on him. Sister Emma, eyes shut and hands pressed to her cheeks, began to shriek,
"Help! Oh, Jesus! Help! Help, sweet Virgin! Help! Help!"
The man gripping Frevis's bridle cried out as he grabbed her kicking foot.
"Hold, sister, hold! We don't mean harm. Hold for God's pity!"
He was ill-dressed and dirty, his red hat filthy, but his voice betrayed he was no peasant. Because of that, and because he had no weapon in his hand, Frevisse hesitated in her struggle. As she did, Sister Emma's shrieking ended abruptly, and Frevisse wrenched around to see her slumping limply from her saddle. The man beside her looked with panic from her to the horse, not certain if he should let go of it to catch her. Belatedly, he tried to do both, but too late. Sister Emma slipped through his hold and fell to the ground with an untidy thump and lay still. Frevis's man seized her moment of distraction to let go her horse, grab her instead by the skirts and drag her from the saddle. Freed and at last frightened, the horse shied away, tossing its head to clear the reins from its feet. Frevisse, clutching at the man to keep from falling headlong, got her feet under her, shoved back, and tried to strike him. He caught her wrists.
"Stand," he ordered. "We have your steward and the other nun. Where can you run? Stand!"
Frevisse stood, braced against his grasp. Sister Emma was motionless in the road. Master Naylor lay face down on the verge, his arm wrenched up across the small of his back toward his shoulders by a broad-muscled man straddling him at the hips. The fourth of their attackers stood over him, Master Naylor's sword in his hand.
"Yield!" the man holding Naylor ordered. "We mean no harm to you, or the sisters. Yield! There's no help for it."
His face white and screwed tight with pain, Naylor nodded. The man eased his hold, rose up from him, and stepped aside. Naylor, wincing, rolled over and sat up, nursing his arm for a moment before rising to his feet. His armed captor topped him by half a head, outmuscled him by several pounds, and was weaponed as well. But Naylor, facing him squarely, demanded,
"What do you want? These are nuns, for God's sake. You're damned if you harm them. We've little to rob, and we'll hardly bring a ransom worth your while. We know who they are, and it's neither ransom nor robbery we want."
The man was rougher of looks and manner than the one still holding Frevisse, but there was nothing threatening in his tone. He grinned.
"All we ask is your company for dinner in the greenwood. Our master sent us for you."
Master Naylor's face registered his irony and disbelief.
"And I suppose your master's name is Robin Hood."
The man grinned wider.
"When it suits him. And that's Little John standing over yon fallen lady, not knowing what to do about her. And Will Scarlet is holding your other."
He made a somewhat respectful bob of his head to Frevisse, then turned to the man beside him.
"Hal, take his dagger too, and let's be away from here." "Will someone come see to this one?"
The rather plaintive plea from the outlaw, still holding Sister Emma's horse, made Frevisse pull against her own captor's hold.
"Let me go to her."
The man promptly released her with a sketch of a bow. She went to kneel beside Sister Emma and found her breathing was suspiciously even and her colour good. Somewhat more sharply than necessary, Frevisse slapped her cheeks and said briskly,
"Wake up, sister, wake up, or I needs must dash water in your face and spoil your wimple. You can't stay here. Wake up."
With soft groans and much fluttering of eyelashes, Sister Emma responded, looking first at Frevisse bending over her and then at the man standing behind her. With a piteous moan, she turned her face away and shut her eyes again.
"Oh, it's not a nightmare. We're ruined, Dame Frevisse. Ruined!"
With quelling asperity, Frevisse said,
"I doubt it."
Whatever these men were about, it hardly seemed rapine or even robbery, to judge by their words and carefulness so far. But Hal had Master Naylor's dagger now, and the sword was still at the steward's chest, and none of them looked inclined to patience. The big man said,
"We can't be biding here on the high road all the afternoon. Help her up, and we'll be going."
Frevisse nodded and rose, pulling on Sister Emma's arm. Little John, and Frevisse doubted that was anything like his proper name, took Sister Emma's other one. Sister Emma shrank from him with small noises of distress and fear, but did not resist beyond that.
"Come on then, sister,"
the man said, not unkindly.
"Let's be away from here."
He grinned and added,
"Welcome to Sherwood."
Chapter 2. The man called Hal chose to be Master Naylor's keeper. He took the steward's sword belt to wear himself, notching it around his waist and sheathing the sword with a satisfied air. But he kept the dagger in hand at Naylor's back while two of the other outlaws tied the dropped bundles to the saddle of one of the horses, and Little John stayed guard by the women. There being no help for any of it, Frevisse stood silently, while Sister Emma first pleaded to be set free, then threatened her brother's vengeance on anyone who touched her, and the sheriff's full rigour if she wasn't sent on her way immediately. And finally, when no one paid heed to any of that, gave herself up to loud crying, clutching Frevisse for support. Over Sister Emma's head, Frevisse met Master Naylor's questioning look and twitched her head in the smallest of negative gestures. There was no hope of any escape that included Sister Emma. She would be as burdensome as wet laundry, and as useful. Careful that none of the outlaws was looking at her, Frevisse silently formed, "You go." He had the best hope of escape, given any kind of chance. Grim-faced, Master Naylor shook his head. He was bound by duty to protect them. He would not desert them, no matter how little help he could offer. And then the man who had captured Frevisse brought a rope from one of the bundles and, with Hal still keeping the dagger at his back, tied Master Naylor's arms behind him.
"Done, Callum," he said.
They followed the road only a little way, then turned aside into a wide grassy path used by timber cutters, Frevisse guessed. But this was not the season for timber cutting, and the outlaws moved with an assurance that showed they expected to meet no one. Well away from the road, Will disappeared into the underbrush with the horses, one tied behind the other.
"Bring them back!" Sister Emma wailed. "You're stealing our horses!"
"They'll keep hidden here till you need them again," said Cullum shortly. "You'll have them back. Now let's be away from here. Will can catch up."
"We're to walk in the woods. Do you know what it's like in the woods? How can you expect me?"
Sister Emma's volume was increasing with her distress. Reading the look on Cullum's face, Frevisse said hurriedly,
"Hush, sister. Be quiet. You're going to make them angry. You don't want them angry, do you?" "My brothers will..."
Sister Emma began loudly, then grasped what Frevisse was saying. She stopped, gaping for a moment, then shut her mouth with an audible snap. Head hunched and hands clasped tightly under her chin, she began to pray, but inaudibly.
"Good," said Cullum.
Beside him, Hal was tightening a blindfold over Master Naylor's eyes. Will came back, with a gesture to Cullum that all was well. Cullum nodded in reply and said,
"Then let's be going. You'll be behind me, steward, with Hal to guide you. Then the women, with Will and John to see to them. No more noise than need be, or we'll have to gag you and sling you from a pole and carry you like a deer's carcass. You understand?"
"Clearly," Master Naylor answered evenly.
Frevisse did not mistake his tone for submission, but Cullum, satisfied, said,
"Good."
He led them off the wide way for a narrower path deeper into the woods. Frevisse, hampered by skirts, wimple and veil among the branches and brush, was thankful she was at least unblindfolded and unbound. Dressed as they were, she and Sister Emma could not flee through the underbrush beyond the path, and the outlaws knew it. And certainly Sister Emma had no thought of escape. She was too busy stumbling over everything in her path, untangling her veil from almost every branch, and sobbing under her breath every prayer she could remember, whether they suited their present trouble or not. Ahead of her, a branch slipped past Cullum's shoulder and whipped across Master Naylor's face. He flinched, but made no outcry. Sister Emma stumbled yet again. John caught her elbow to steady her, but she jerked it indignantly from his hold, then tripped again and fell to her knees with a miserable cry. Master Naylor started to turn, demanding,
"What?"
But Frevisse said quickly,
"It's all right. She only tripped,"
before Hal could do anything to him. He faced forward again, but Sister Emma wailed from the ground.
"It's not all right. I can't do this."
Before any of the men could intervene, Frevisse hissed,
"Hush! They'll gag you if you keep on this way. Be quiet."
Sister Emma gulped, cast a cringing look at John looming beside her, and let Frevisse help her to her feet. They went on. She pretended to be absorbed in managing herself and Sister Emma along the narrow path, but she was also trying to memorise the way they went. Left along a dry stream cut, right at a fallen tree caught in the crotch of another, left again in sight of a tall broken stump. The way was deliberately tangled, she thought, and was doubtful she would be able to find her way back, even if she had the chance, but at least she could try. At last they came into a large clearing. It was ringed by wide-trunked trees, with sunlight and flowers in its long grass, and the air fragrant with the smell of roasting venison. A half-dozen roughly dressed men were scattered around the shade. One of them, seated on a great tree root across the clearing, plucked lightly at a lute, so apparently at ease that he did not even look up as they came by. The others lounged to their feet, looking uncertain how to respond to the presence of two nuns in their midst,
except one, who moved forward with a confidence that said he was their leader. He was perhaps near 40, dressed in the plain-cut green tunic of a forester, but the belt and pouch and dagger sheath at his waist were of richly finished leather. He was smiling, and there was charm in both his smile and the way he said to Cullum,
"Take off his blindfold. There's no need now. Let him see for himself we mean no harm, neither to him nor these fair ladies."
While he spoke, he looked quickly, assessingly, from Sister Emma's rather dazed, damp, tear-reddened face to Frevisse, standing cold-eyed and calm beside her. His smile deepened, and bypassing Master Naylor and Sister Emma both, he went down on one knee in front of Frevisse.
"Good cousin, I pray your forgiveness for this unseemly meeting. I could find no better way."
Frevisse, ready for a great many possibilities at that moment, but not that one, stared. The man lifted his head. A little pleadingly, he said,
"Don't you remember me at all then, cousin?"
Frevisse began to shake her head. But something in him, maybe the mischief behind his eyes, even while he pleaded, awakened memory. And suddenly, despite the changes in him, he was familiar.
"Nicholas!" she exclaimed.
Her father's older brother's elder son, and indeed her cousin, though they had not met for almost 20 years. He sprang to his feet, holding out his hands to her.
"You'd always more wits than any three other women together. I knew you'd remember."
In the surprise of the moment, Frevisse held out her own hands to clasp his.
"Of course I remember. At Uncle Thomas's. You were there in his household that whole season, from Michaelmas until after Christmastide."
And had been sent away in disgrace, she remembered, because of too many jokes and insolences, and finally, for trying to seduce a serving girl. There was clearly nothing of that scandal in Nicholas's mind. He grinned broadly at her, holding her hands in his own hard, strong ones.
"You were an earnest creature then, forever tucked away in Uncle Thomas's library, despite all Aunt Matilda tried to do to have you out of there. Are you still that earnest?"
"Are you still a teasing rogue?"
Frevisse retorted. Nicholas threw back his head and laughed.
"Yes, yes, indeed I am." "And you could find no other way than this for a reunion?"
Master Naylor asked, his voice dry and edged. Nicholas looked around at him with plain surprise, as if he had forgotten there was anyone there but himself and Frevisse. His demeanour changed quickly to apologetic.
"Now, here I'm at fault to neglect you, sir, and you, good lady."
He turned his smile on Sister Emma, who in the surprises of the moment was staring from him to Frevisse and back again, for a wonder both wordless and tearless. But as he bowed elegantly to her, she remembered herself and drew away from him with a sniff and a trembling chin. Nicholas's smile turned rueful.
"You've indeed been poorly handled, gentle lady. Let me make amends, I pray you."
He stepped back, drew himself up straight, and swept a low bow to all three of them.
"By your gracious leave, good master and fair ladies, let me invite you to our feast this day. We dine not elegantly, but well, and I swear you would be no more honourably received in even the highest hall of the land."
Frevisse looked pointedly aside to Master Naylor's bound hands. Nicholas took her meaning and gestured to Cullum.
"Free him. He knows now we mean no harm. I've given my oath and am Dame Frevisse's cousin into the bargain. He'll give no trouble. Will you, man?" "Leave the ladies untouched, and you'll have no trouble from me."
Nicholas put up a hand in ready oath.
"As I pray for God's grace, they'll come to no harm that I can keep them from."
Master Naylor, rubbing his rope-marked wrists, eyed him coldly. Nicholas turned to Frevisse.
"There'll be food soon. Will you talk with me the while until we eat?"
Rather than answering, Frevisse was gazing past him at the lute player, still playing on the far side of the clearing. He had remained bent over his lute, his face half unseen, but with an air of listening as intently as his fellows to everything that passed.
"I know him from somewhere," Frevisse murmured.
Nicholas glanced around to see whom she was looking at, and shrugged. I doubt it, unless your prioress lets wandering minstrels play for her nuns upon occasion. Which Domina Edith certainly did not. But Frevisse was the priory's hosteler, in charge of the guests that the Benedictine rule required every house to provide for. The lute player might well have spent the night sometime. The feeling was so strong that she would have gone to speak to him, but Nicholas led her aside to where a blanket had been spread on the ground at the foot of the largest tree. Sister Emma made to follow, but one of the outlaws stepped in her way with what could pass for a polite murmur, and Master Naylor took her by the arm, speaking quickly in her ear. Tears threatened for a moment, but then Master Naylor took her by the arm, speaking quickly in her ear, as he led her with the outlaw to another tree and blanket. Frevisse, satisfied they would be all right, gave her attention to Nicholas. He gestured down. Be seated, if it please you. Grateful, Frevisse sank down on the blanket. It had been fine once, thick and closely woven, but was filthy now with hard use. Nicholas sat down on the tree root beside her and leaned forward, hands clasped between his knees. For a moment, they looked at each other. Frevisse was remembering how he had been when they were young. He had been tall, and still was, though somewhat stooped. He had been slender. He was now gaunt. His thick brown hair was further back from his forehead, and there was grey scattered through his curls. Laughter had always lurked behind his eyes, even in what should have been his most solemn moments, and it was still there. But so was weariness, and there were deep-set lines beside his mouth and around his eyes. He was older, and he had changed, except for the lurking merriment behind his eyes. "You're looking more solemn than you need to, cousin," he said. He had used to grin down at her, much as he was now, when about to tease away her anger at him. She was not angry with him now, nor much in the mood for being teased. "Remembering you and how you came to be an outlaw is enough to make me solemn." "Ah." Nicholas looked away from her. "There were mistakes, and then more mistakes. Some folk, and particularly my father, always said I would go too far. One day, I finally did. I've been paying for it a long time."
"Almost 16 years."
"That long." He looked a little startled, thinking of it, and then agreed. "Yes, it has been, I suppose. You always tended to be right. I remember that." He had been in his early 20s, his father's heir to two good manors, when he ran afoul of a local lord, unamused by some escapade of his. Frevisse did not know all the matter of it, but what had been a slight matter had escalated to a quarrel and then to an armed skirmish. Men had been killed on both sides, and Nicholas's own father had refused to back him or stand out against the decree of outlawry a Staffordshire sheriff had brought down on him. In answer, Nicholas had disappeared into the Derby Hills, and that had been the last Frevisse knew of him, until today. The Derby Hills were a long way from southern Oxfordshire.
"Your father died," she said.
"I know. I used to learn things about home. But it's been a while now. Edward?"
"He was well, the last I heard, a year ago. And his wife and children."
"He has children?"
"Two sons and two daughters. The oldest boy is named Edward, after his father."
"And the younger? Not Nicholas, by any chance?"
"Not by any chance," Frevisse agreed. "He's named after his grandfather."
Nicholas looked down at his hands. They had been clever, graceful hands when he was young. Now they were broad and blunt, roughened and weather-browned, like his face. Barely above a whisper, he said, "I want to go home, cousin."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.